All right, so the guy walks in late to the class, and I ask him, why are you late? He says, look, I'm coming all the way from Noida, and it's a long way off, so I'm late. Yeah. And then I ask the rest of the class, anybody else coming here from Noida? Well, three students raised their hands. So clearly, there is one kind of a reasoning being forwarded by this person who has walked in late, which is not really a valid reason, because you have enough examples to prove that is not right. Now, this kind of a reasoning is what is called deductive reasoning. Meaning, there is a premise and there are conclusions, and the premises or conclusions can be linked, either they are valid or they are not valid. For example, this was a case where it was not valid. The reasoning is not valid. You can easily refute that argument. On the other hand, if we look at a situation where I say the sun will rise tomorrow in the east, and what is the reason for that? Well, you can say forever, time immemorial, sun has been rising in the east. Well, that is not a guarantee that the sun will rise in the east tomorrow again. This is not a valid reason for that. Okay, it has been doing so far, but doesn't mean it's going to rise again on the east. But nonetheless, there is a very strong reason for us to believe that the sun will rise on the east again, simply because there is a weight of evidence behind us. So the former example is an example of deductive reasoning, where you know the premise and the conclusions are linked either they are validly, their link is valid, or they are invalid. The second kind of an example, or let's say Virat Kohli is applying some cream or on his face and his face lights up and all, and people assume it will work for us. These kinds of reasoning are not valid reasons, but they are inductive reasoning. Meaning, because it has, so we are talking about how strongly we can say that this is a good reason that this will work. It is a good reason that the sun will rise on the east tomorrow, since it has been rising in the east. So reasoning or arguments can be organized in these two branches. One is the deductive reasoning, where you want to see whether the logic is valid or invalid, or there is an inductive reasoning where you look at the logic, the strength of the logic. So it could be a weak argument or it could be a very strong argument. A weak argument means, okay, fairness things may work because it works on three other people. That's a weak, may be a weak argument. But sun rising in the east tomorrow is a very strong evidence-based argument. So analytics is actually helping you to build strong inductive arguments. That is the whole purpose of doing analytics. And data mining, being a subset of this whole story, is also looking at data, trying to build strong reasons why a certain thing is workable or why we believe it will work. It is never going to say it will work, because the reasoning will never be valid. You will always find counter examples to what are your hypothesis or what you believe will happen. That is always there. But there will be a strength in your argument. In other words, you'll be able to say, look, there is an evidence to suggest that these things will happen, or this is how it works, or this is why this loan will be defaulted, etc., etc. So part of analytics is really trying to strengthen your quality of arguments by providing you evidence for good inductive arguments. Okay, so whether it is regression or clustering or decision tree and other kinds of things that we're going to do, the whole purpose is to be able to build sound and strong, not sound is not the right word, strong inductive arguments and not valid arguments. Valid arguments come from a different, kind of a different approach. Okay. What is clustering? Think of a very large mobile subscriber with millions of customers, and it wants to promote a new product, a mobile service provider. It wants a new service or a new product or a new 3G plan. You know, every customer is not the same. You know, so there are customers would have their own preferences, their own you know, likes, dislikes, own values. So if you are somehow able to, in your large customer base, you're able to make groups out of those customer bases, then you are your targeting, your precision of approaching the customer with the right product becomes much more meaningful, much more easier, much more doable. So the idea is your success chances improve. So clustering is one way to approach large data sets to find out segments within those data sets, so that you can target your strategies to various segments. A retail store, for example, could have, 500 stores across the country. Let's say it's a chain. But if it has to decide on a marketing strategy, for each of these stores, it has two options. One option is it can do 500 different strategies, completely complex job to do, implement, monitor, supervise. Or it could do one strategy for all the 500 stores. But there could be something, some solution in between. It could cluster or group these stores by whatever characteristics into five or six buckets, and then come out with five or six very distinct strategies which could be far more effective, and yet one can also monitor them quickly. So the idea of clustering is very simple, is to be able to let the data speak and organize themselves into groups based on whatever information that this data carries. Okay? It is a grouping of data objects so that the objects within a group are very similar, so you know what is your target, and objects across groups are different. So this is just a pictorial representation of them. So each of these little circles is a cluster. The idea is that within the clusters, they are fairly homogeneous, meaning their distances are minimum, and those between the clusters, the distance is maximized. And that is the whole principle of clustering. It can also help occasionally to find out there are some outliers in your data set or not. Meaning, you may find clusters which are very small. Extreme case could be a cluster. The algorithm reveals a cluster which is just one unit or one example. Then clearly that particular observation does not belong to the others and fairly different. So that's another way of using the output of a clustering process. Clustering is also an important pre-processing step. For example, if you're doing regression or a logistic regression or anything, and let's say you are doing it on loan default data, and you want to find probabilities of loan default using a logistic regression. One way to do it, obviously, have your entire data set of defaulted loans and not defaulted loans and run a logistic regression, estimate probabilities and use it for future. The other approach is, if you have significant amount of data, is to first do a clustering of the entire data set so that you know that there are certain borrower characteristics which may organize themselves into smaller groups rather than one very large group. And you can build models on individual groups so that your precision, your assumptions are stronger, they hold more within those groups, and your precision and the model might work much better than if you treat the whole data set as one big piece. So clustering is not necessarily the final thing. It can be an important intermediate step in the whole life cycle of an analytic project. Occasionally, it can also be the only final outcome because you want to understand your population better. It might just serve as a good process to understand better. That might be the only desired outcome that you have. I want to understand my customer base better. I want to profile them, give them some 5-6 names, all my customer base, so that I know what I'm talking about and communicate to my marketing team as to how to reach which segment. Okay? So it can be both as an intermediate step, and or it could be a pre-processing step for other kinds of algorithms, other kinds of applications to run. Okay, so the basic question is, we have to somehow find out whether two individuals or two objects are similar, or whether two objects are different. So we need to find out a good measure of what is similar. What do you mean by similarity? And then we need to find out how do we partition those objects. So usually data objects consist of a set of attributes, or which we call columns or variables. So there could be real valued attributes, there could be binary attributes, there could be categorical attributes, meaning categorical variables, or ranked attributes. Clustering algorithms work very well with real valued attributes, okay, where you have numbers like age and income and height and things like that. With categorical or binary kind of attributes, there are other methods of distance, but that science is still very, not very, I would say, settled. It is still evolving and algorithms are still being developed. So typically you will have clustering examples or exercises or in practice would be largely dependent on real valued numbers. Okay, real valued attributes would be used to cluster. Alright, so let's, what are the distances? I'll share this PPT. So we want to find out, okay, there are two objects, object A and object B. We want to find out a distance measure between them. And if this distance is between A and B is smaller than distance between B and C, then we know A and B are together, C is probably not together, okay? So we will have to find out what is a distance measure. There are many options in the algorithms, but typically a distance measure should have basically these properties. It has to be a non-negative measure, obviously. If I and j are two objects, then the distance between I and j has to be a non-zero, non-negative, and the distance between two objects which are same should always be zero, and it doesn't matter whether you're computing a distance between A and B or a B and A, it should be ideally the same, symmetry, and distance between two objects, triangular distance between IH and J should be typically more than sum of two sides of a triangle being more than the third side. The definitions of distance functions are usually different for real valued attributes, binary attributes, categorical attributes and things like that. And occasionally you may weight these variables. So for example, because of your understanding of the business, you may find that, look, I'll give twice as more emphasis to age as I will give to income in computing the distance between objects. Okay, because you think age for you is far more important. Okay, maybe you are in a long-term insurance plan, you know, old care insurance plan is what you're looking at. And for you, age is a much more important variable than income. And so in order to create those distances, you want to give more importance to age and lesser importance to income, and we can see how we do all of that. So typically some distance measure has to be computed among objects. So typically, this is how your data should look like. You will have, there are n rows, and those are the attributes. This is your typically how your data, Excel data, or any data format would look like, or a table would look like. Using this data set, a matrix is computed, which is really the fundamental input to any clustering algorithm. So the distances between all the objects, obviously the diagonal will be zero. So for example, this D21 means distance between object 2 and object 1, and distance 31 is whatever, there will be some numbers will be there. This matrix is the fundamental input that is needed for the clustering algorithm. Okay, this matrix is used to calculate the distances and reorganize and group the numbers. This algorithm is not implemented very well, but this is an input you can remember, is that, as I said, clustering algorithms work well on real value numbers, so like age, height, income, where you have numbers to deal with. But there is another measure of distance which can be supplemented along with that, is called a Jaccard distance. A Jaccard distance is computed when you have binary kind of a, you know, matrix. Suppose, to give you an example, suppose you run a shadi.com kind of a website, and your USP is that we help match better. Okay, so in other words, we have a sophisticated algorithm which will match, find you the right groom or the bride because of that matching algorithm. And all the matching algorithm does is It collects a set of inputs from you when you fill up a form. It says, okay, do you like football? Do you like shopping? Do you like traveling? Do you like kids? Do you like X, Y, Z? These are all binary answers. So yes is a 1 and a 0 is a no. And so you'll have pairs of people. And then how does one find whether a person, a man A and a woman X, are a good fit by looking at their likes and dislikes? I mean, you can't do it by hand every time when you have thousands of things. If that is the case and dealing only with binary numbers, one can look at what is called a Jaccard distance. A Jaccard distance is simply a measure of number of times where X and Y both are one. Okay, both are one. And the denominator is, this Jaccard similarity, so distance is 1 minus that. A number of times X or Y is 1. So suppose we have got 6 questions. Individual person A has answered question 1 as yes and 4, 5, 6 as yes. And person Y has answered question 2 and 3 as yes and question 5 as yes. Then the numerator is, we have to find where is X and Y both saying a yes. 0 is not treated to be same. Yes, no means not yes. So it is not typically treated as, okay, 2 zeros doesn't mean that they are same. If the question typically is, do you like pets? Yes, but no doesn't really mean I hate pets. You know, so therefore that's a little fuzzy whether it is no in that sense or not. So 2 zeros are not treated to be same. It is only the ones that are compared. So you see, only in question number 5, both X and Y agree. So the numerator is 1. And the places where either X or Y is 1 is here X is 1, here Y is 1, here X. So all the 6 are actually covered. So the denominator is 1 by 6. So the similarity measure between these two individuals is 1 by 6. In other words, they are fairly not similar. You know, they are fairly far apart in terms of their likes and dislikes. And Jaccard distance is 1 minus the similarity measure, which is 5 by 6. So when you have just pure binary kind of data sets, Jaccard distance can be used to calculate the distance matrix. So this would be an input to your, so this D, suppose X was 1 and Y was 2, then this D 2 1 would be 5 by 6. That is the distance between individuals 2 and 6. But these kind of algorithms are still not well implemented, because in real life data sets there will be just a few binary things, but majority will be real life attributes. So other distance measured comes from when we are dealing with real valued numbers, and everything is derived from this, which is called the Minkowski's very general form of distance. If you substitute P with 2, it becomes the Euclidean distance. And that is typically the distance measure that is computed in clustering algorithms. So it is like, I've given some formats of this. If you put P equals to 2, it becomes your typical Euclidean distance, X distance between two points, x1 minus x2 whole square plus y1 minus y2 whole square under root. Okay, so these are the ways to compute distances, and most software programs will be using Euclidean distance to compute that distance matrix, which is the fundamental input to a clustering algorithm.